we'll get going. Okay, welcome to the 29th Reading Online Research Sports Economics Research Seminar. We have today Dimitris Karlis from the Athens University of Economics and Business to present Uncertainty in Competitive Balance, a Model-Based Approach. Really pleased to have Dimitris speaking. Many of us in the sport economic literature have relied on Dimitris's bivariate Poisson models and other R code over the years, and many of us will know Dimitris and Ioannis also from the Mathsport conference that took place back in those pre-COVID days when we used to meet physically.
Long ago,
it seems. As always, please do keep yourselves on mute while Dimitris is talking. He has about an hour to talk. He may take a little bit less, but he has an hour, and then we've got about 30 minutes or so for Q&A, should we need it. Feel free to ask questions in the chat. And also, if you can't see the chat, due to whatever reasons, the quirks of Microsoft, feel free to drop me an email if you have a question you want to ask. And at the end, we'll have, as I said, a Q&A session. So without any further delay, Dimitris, please do take away your presentation.
Okay. Let me share my screen. Okay, can you see my screen?
Almost. There you go. Got it.
Even better. So thanks for being here late at Friday. Thanks, James, for this kind invitation, for this talk. Yes, indeed, it has been a long time ago, about the conference in Athens, and it is supposed that the next one will be in Reading. So I was thinking of being in Reading this July 2021, but I don't know what is going on there. Anyway, so what I'm going to present today is my joint work with Ioannis about uncertainty competitive balance, focusing on football, of course. And the idea is to see how our model-based approach can help understand the uncertainty when we are measuring competitive balance. So the idea has to do with the following. I mean, competitive balance is now a very standard, let's say, approach. A lot of people are working on that, and I'm going to show you a few results on that in order to introduce what's going on. However, a very big, let's say, dilemma, or let's say a very big question is, how do we account for uncertainty? And as uncertainty, I mean the following. So here, what you see, I don't know if you can see my cursor. Do you?
Yep, we can see the cursor, yep.
Okay, so the idea here is that we see a competitive balance index called normalized concentration ratio for the first place. And we see this for Germany, Bundesliga, and the Premier League. So we see this from 2000 across to 2017. And you see that England has a bigger value. So the idea is that if the smaller the value, the more competition in the championship. So the idea here is, you see that England started, let's say, above Germany, but around 2010, because of Bayern Munich domination in German league, we see a change. However, the big issue here is that, well, if we see, let's say, let's go here in 2005, is this difference a real difference, or it is just because of uncertainty and realization of such indices? Because recall that when I measure an index of competitive balance, I just report one number based on a league that has its own uncertainty and, let's say, its own variability. So the idea for this talk today is how we can account for this uncertainty when we measure competitive balance index, and what is the implication of this. So, for example, we see some random fluctuations for England, But could this be just a random fluctuation around a certain value, or it is something, let's say, more intrinsic and something that we should check why we do have, let's say, this fluctuation? Or we see in Germany that after 2010, we have much bigger values, but the idea is that can this account for these particular changes we see? So this is what about I'm going to talk today. So we want to take into account uncertainty, and we propose a model-based approach to account for uncertainty in the sense that we assume an underlying model, and based on this model, we try to see how much variability this model generates to our data. And of course, there is a very big question here. Well, if we change the model, do we have very different results? So we want to see issues about the robustness about all this approach. Be aware that this is ongoing work, so comments are more than welcome, and any criticism is again welcome, and I would like to have feedback if possible. So from the plot, I will try to answer some questions. Does Bundesliga differ from Premier League? Is the difference between the red and the black lines a real one, or it is just because of randomness? Do we have changes over time? How we could, let's say, have a fair comparison about that? And at the end of the day, there is another question saying, well, if there is no, let's say, if all the teams had equal strength, what we would expect? I'm posing this question because when we calculate the indices, we are making such assumptions, but as we will see, these assumptions are in the wrong direction, and we want to clarify a little bit what's going on in this case. So let me introduce competitive balance. Perhaps a lot of you are familiar with competitive balance, so perhaps it is not something new for you. However, competitive balance has been a very central concept in economic analysis for professional sports. And it has to do with the degree of equality of the strengths of the teams. So it is assumed, or let's say it is considered, that if we have a championship with all teams of equal strength, this creates more competitive, more competition. So actually, this can be very important for many reasons, because, for example, in econometrics, there is quite a lot of research on how much competitive balance affects attendance, sport attendance. This sounds a little bit ironic in our days when no fans are allowed in most of the European courts. So this is, let's say, something that we would like to see how COVID has, let's say, influenced these kind of things. And of course, competitive balance is also strongly related with the uncertainty of the outcome. And there is a very strong relationship about the uncertainty of the outcome of a match and a lot of economic implications around that. So very, very common, let's say, to consider competitive balance indices in many different sports. And I must say that this creates quite a lot of indices suitable for some sports and not for some other. And the idea is that while uncertainty and competitive balance is something that makes sports very challenging, we must think that uncertainty is always present within a match or within a season. And typically, most of the indices are calculated based on the final standings, which is also a realization, a random process. So the idea is that what we see at the end of the season is just a realization of some underlying process, and we would like to see how much variability is there. And typically, most of the indices, if not all, that we are using in competitive balance research are just descriptive measures. So it is just, let's say, a number calculated most of the time by the final standings. And actually, this can be a little problematic when we don't take into account the uncertainty around that. So a few more things about competitive balance in order, let's say, to create the frame for my talk. Competitive balance is complicated just because it is a multidimensional concept. It is also a very big discussion or even dispute what kind of indices we should track or what kind of indices we should report in order to measure the competitive balance. And of course, there is quite, let's say, a strong implication of competitive balance in many econometric studies and a lot of issues related to football economics. It is also a big, let's say, discussion that competitive balance is very important for the viability of European football, in the sense that if European football stops to be competitive, perhaps a lot of money will transfer to some other sports that offer, let's say, more uncertainty and more fun. And a second very important point is that even if today I will focus on football, there are quite a lot of indices more suitable for other sports as well. And of course, I need to talk a little bit how do we modify our approach for other sports as well. I also start from a statement that I don't assume that there is any optimal index for calculating competitive balance. So what I'm going to try is to show for a few indices what's going on, but actually the approach is too generic to be used for other indices as well. Okay, another important assumption that I need to make at this level is that typically when we compare, when we describe or calculate indices for competitive balance, there are three different dimensions that we can use. The first one is the match level. So we want to measure the strength difference in a match level. There is the seasonal level, which relates to measures about the performance of teams within a season, but also there are some between seasons measures that capture the relative performance across seasons. So my talk today is based mainly on the second one, about the seasonal measures of competitive balance, but I will talk a little bit how do we extend to between seasons or even match competitive balance indices. Some ideas about calculate has to do with, let's say, for the match level, we can have the percent of points difference between the teams or the percent of wins difference, some information from betting odds, probabilities given by the different bookmakers, or even say the attendance when the match uncertainty reaches some specific point. About the seasonal, and this is something quite important for my work later on, most of the indices has to do about the concentration or variability or dispersion of points calculated at the end of the league of the season, or even the win percentage of the teams at the end of the season. So for the seasonal, let's say, case, most of the indices are based on some variability or say concentration. Being statistician, I think that concentration and variability are quite the same thing, at least to my eyes. I mean that all the measures of variability can be considered as measures of concentration and the opposite. So for this reason, I put them in the same order. And of course, there are also some fewer measures about the domination of a team and all that. About between season, I think that we need to correlate, let's say, a little bit the outcome of one season to the next or the previous one. So this is the kind of indices that I'm going to consider here. Okay, a few more points about the indices. Typically, in order to have something which is comparable, we would like to standardize in some reference, let's say, interval, typically from 0 to 1. And this creates some ability to compare between different leagues. In Bundesliga, we have 18 teams. In Premier League, we have 20 teams. So we would like to be able to compare between the two different things. There is also a kind of competitive balance that relates to promotion or relegation rule. So, for example, if we consider between season, we may have different teams or, let's say, different number of teams, and we have to account for this. And also, there are multiple levels of competitions, and perhaps some leagues are not very competitive, let's say, for the first place, but they can be very competitive for the other places. And this is something also quite interesting and important. Okay, about the uncertainty, the literature is quite little. I mean, there is quite very few papers that relate the uncertainty around the indices. And this is what we try, let's say, to work a little bit here. So the reported indices are just descriptive measures. So actually, they are point estimates of what they are assumed to estimate. And as point estimates based on data, they must have some kind of variance. So actually, we treat here the indices as a realizations of an underlying process, and I will explain this in a few minutes. So we would like to be able to estimate some variability around them, and we need to have a general methodology applicable as far as possible to different kind of indices, or let's say to different type of models, or let's say sports, in order to work with. Okay, for that, I must say the following. One may say, well, okay, if your index is just a variability index, like let's say the entropy or the Gini index of concentration, the literature from other disciplines may contain some variance estimators. However, here a very important result, an important, let's say, note applies, in the sense that typically in sports and typically in football, because today I'm talking in football, all the indices are calculated by the final standings, and actually this implies that we have summarized the data to some number, and then from this summary we calculate another, the final index. So actually there are two different levels of variability here, and if we just calculate some variability measure from the final standings, perhaps we miss the underlying process that has generated this random table of final standings. So this is what I'm trying today to resolve as far as possible. Okay, so there are quite a lot of indices here, but perhaps I will skip this at the moment, and I'm going to show you a little further. So the idea is that for most of the indices, we are assuming that they range within a certain interval, let's say that they will take values from 0 to 1. So typically, we assume the kind of perfect balance. So for example, let me use just such an index. The first one, index for today, is the normalized concentration ratio. So the normalized concentration ratio with index k measures how much the first k teams dominate the champion. So here what you see is that PI is the number of points the ith team has gained at the final standings. So here we just add the number of points for the first K teams. This is what we would expect by chance. And this is something, this is, let's say, the upper limit, in the sense that we make this between 0 and 1. So the central point in this index is that we would like to see how many points we would expect, or how many points the first K teams received, how many we would expect. So actually, in case of perfect balance, as perfect balance, I mean the case when perfect balance means that all teams gain the same number of points. So in this case, the total number of points in a league of n teams, each one playing with the others two times, one away and one at home, the total number should be this one, 2 times n, n minus 1. And so for each team, we'll take 2 multiplied by n minus 1 points. So the top k teams will have 2 times n minus 1 point. So actually, if you go here, my index will take the value 0. Okay, and in the case of a perfect imbalance, I am expecting that this index will go up to 1. Okay, keep the following. under perfect balance, what I expect to see based on this index is zero. But in practice, what do we mean by perfect balance? I mean, I can interpret this perfect balance thing in two different ways. So here, my results will be using k equal 1. So actually, this is exactly the index that I'm going to use. But I want to keep in mind what I said. What is perfect balance in our case? So I said under perfect balance, all teams gain the same number of points. Do you think that this is this possible for a league? I mean, I can interpret that balance means something else. All the teams have the same strength. This is also a very equivalent and perhaps a better assumption about a perfect balance means. So I change a little bit what we assume as perfect balance. So perfect balance means that I have teams and all the teams can win, have, let's say, the same scoring ability. And in this case, when they play together, I don't have a clue which one. I mean, they do have the same probability of winning each game. This is a different, let's say, assumption and approach about perfect balance. And also, this way, we can define the opposite one, which is what I call perfect imbalance. So for perfect balance, we assume that every team in the ith position wins the following n minus I teams. So the first, the best team wins all the others. The second best loses from the first one and wins all the others, and so on. So actually, this means that if we have something like that, we assume that the strength of the teams are ordered, but it is not that easy anymore to define what is this. Okay, so having said that, I would like to show the following. So if we assume something like that, consider my very first and very simplistic model. So my model is as simple as follows. We assume that we have n teams and a round robin tournament. So everybody plays with all the others two times. And each team has a scoring ability denoted as lambda I. And the number of goals of the ith team versus team J are denoted as XI and YJ. And we assume a very simplistic Poisson distribution with the same with parameters lambda I and lambda J. So under my idea of a perfect balance, all teams are of equal strength and all lambda I equal to some general lambda for all the teams. So this is my assumption and not the assumption that they all have the same, let's say, points. And based on that, if I simulate a championship, so I simulate values. I mean, I take the schedule of the championship and I simulate values from the Poisson distribution. And at the end of the day, I take the final standing. And I calculate my index, and I repeat this a lot of time. But be aware that even if you have teams of equal strength, definitely at the end of the day, some team, just because of randomness, will have more points, and this team will win the championship. So actually, the assumption that based on teams of equal strength, we will have a perfectly balanced final standing table is perhaps a very misleading assumption, because we all know, and this is, let's say, my plot. So this is about 1,000 replications. So for 1,000 replications here, you see that there is always a first team, because this is ordered statistics anymore. And you see that based on the assumption that they all have equal number of points, this is something that never happened. So you see here that if I go one step further, so if I add the within season variability, the variability inside the season that creates the final standings, I can have a very different idea what is a perfect balance and how much of the outcome comes because of just randomness. And to make you feel a little more on that, this is, let's say, my index. Recall that under the assumption of perfect balance, this index is assumed to take a value of zero. So you see that out of 10,000 replications here, with a number of teams equal to 20, I never had a value below 0.1. So you see that on average, I have numbers around 0.25, even if my theory says that this should be zero. So actually, if I translate this, consider a league and the observed value of the normalized concentration ratio is 0.25. Well, this is far away from zero towards one, but actually this is something that can happen just because I have equal strength, teams of equal strength. So this is the kind of uncertainty that I would like to take into account when I calculate an index, and this is what we're working about. So this is the normalized concentration ratio. I have another index that I skip. This is the Herfindahl-Hinzmann index. So this is borrowed from economics. This has to do, I mean, this index is very popular as a measure of the, let's say, the concentration in different industries. And actually, when we calculate this index for football purposes, we use this kind of measure. This is the HHI index, where WI is the proportion of wins for team I. So you see that, again, if I assume that all teams win the same percentage of matches, then this is going to be, let's say, around zero. But actually, in practice, this is not going to happen just because of variability. I also need to say here that when I'm using this index in my talk today, I'm using the normalized version. So we know it can be seen from theory that the lower limit is 1 over n, while the upper limit is this quantity here. If I have a 2-1-0 system, if I have a 3-1-0 system, I can, let's say, find again everything. So the idea is that I have 0 for total balance and 1 for total imbalance. So if I calculate the same numbers for my experiment, I got this. This should be zero based on theory, but actually I never had a value of zero. And you see that my value is concentrated 0.5, and I have never seen a zero value. And also, if you compare the two indices, there is something also quite interesting in the sense that they have a very different range of values. So actually, what I am expecting to come out from my research is to see that, well, there are some indices that they have a big inherent variability that perhaps are not very good to be used in practice, because actually the uncertainty around their value is so large that they don't add to our knowledge in any. So this is, let's say, my starting point for this research. A very important, a very nice point here is that if I average my 10,000 replications and I take the final standings based on averaging all the 10,000 replications, I'm pretty close to the general theory, yes, because if I average all the results about the teams, then I got a value close to zero. So actually, you see that what comes out from all this is that there are two levels of variability. The one level is the variability we see at the final standings, and one level of variability, which is the inherent variability that we would like to take into account, and it is because of the different matches so far. So it is important to reconsider what is a perfect balance, and based on this approach, it is interesting to see how we can, if we report such a measure, how we can have, let's say, an uncertainty around that, and how we can have, let's say, a confidence interval or any other measure of variability. So our approach is model-based in the sense that it is based on some underlying model. I understand that assuming an underlying model, we have to be very cautious, because if we start with a very wrong model, we can have very wrong results. But on the other hand, take into account that the most important thing here is to take into account the variability. So we need a model to account for the variability. And for this reason, we have done some robustness research in the sense to see if we deviate from a model, do we change a lot of results? So our approach is that we fit a plausible model in the data. I will give you more examples, more details in a few minutes. Then based on the fitted model, we simulate a number of links. And for each link, we calculate the quantities of interest. And of course, replicating this procedure, at the end of the day, we can see what is the real uncertainty for each index. So it is not, let's say, a simplistic bootstrap approach in the sense that we just replicate the final standings. Here we replicate the entire championship, and we based on that our index, our, let's say, variability calculation. So keep in mind that we need a model for that. So in a few minutes, I will show a model which, as correctly expect, relates to the model that we have worked with Ioannis so many years. So what kind of model we need for doing something like that? The literature of statistical models for football is increasing extremely fast, and there is quite a lot of new models every year. So if I have, let's say, to put in categories, we have models that try to model the win, loss, draw, let's say, case. This is sufficient for our research. So if I have, let's say, an ordinal regression model, I can take back what I would like to have. So for example, if I have a Bradley-Terry model that allows for draws, this can recreate my league. So this is, let's say, a plausible model. There are also quite a lot of models about score modeling. Fewer models about, let's say, time between goals modeling. I call this survival modeling. Of course, there are quite a lot of models about the game characteristics or, let's say, econometric aspects, which are not, let's say, very useful at this moment. However, we try to check whether we can gain information by using some more complicated models for this reason. So here, I focus on modeling the outcome of a game. And in particular, I'm trying to model the score. So there is a very big literature on that, starting from, let's say, double Poisson models, or models, bivariate Poisson models, or bivariate Poisson models with inflation, or bivariate Poisson models for extravert dispersion. There is some literature right now about the copula-based models. And of course, there are, you can change the Poisson assumption with any other kind of assumption in order to create as many models as possible. Here, I'm going to use, let's say, the first two categories of models, the double Poisson and the bivariate Poisson. And I'm using two, let's say, category of models because I would like to see how much I can inflate my results if I change the assumption about correlation between the outcomes. Okay, so here is my results. So this is all you have seen so far. So I have shown data from Premier League and Bundesliga from 2000 up to 2017. We do have more data, but I apologize that I could not compile the results for today's talk. And I'm going to present a lot of indices, but I concentrate on those two indices, the normalized concentration ratio and the Herfindahl-Hirschman index. So here is my initial plot. So this is the starting point. So here I will add, let's say, some confidence intervals. So you see, this is what I have reported. This is just the descriptive measure. And here is that I put, let's say, some confidence intervals. So you see that there are quite a lot of interesting things here. First of all, see that the confidence intervals for some particular indices are quite high. So you see that while I observe, let's say, here a value about 0.65, my interval can go up from 0.5 up to 0.8 almost. And this variability is very large because at the end of the day, even if I have a lot of data, if I have a lot of scores, I summarize my index just by using the final standings. So actually, I get rid of a lot of information that exists in the matches, and I'm just using, let's say, the final table. So if you see this plot, it is interesting that for some areas, let's say if you see here, one may say, well, England has a much larger index, but actually if you compare the confidence intervals, they don't, let's say, behave, they don't differ statistically significant. So actually, there are two findings here. The first one is that the uncertainty around such indices is quite high, and perhaps these indices, they do not say so many things that we think that we know about that. And the second one is that if we compare different across time, or let's say between different countries, we can see that while we see differences in the observed values, then there is no underlying difference between them. I also put in this, what is the confidence interval? I mean that if I assume that all teams are of equal strength, what I would expect to see. So here you see the red lines is the confidence interval for England, while the black lines are the confidence interval for Germany. So you see here something interesting, that there are some periods that what I have observed for this particular index, but I will show you the same for the other index as well, is perhaps not very far away from what I would expect just because of randomness. So you see that even in the case of equal strength, there are some cases that the level of uncertainty in the index is so big that it is not significantly different than the assuming equal strength. And you see also that this is what I mentioned earlier. You see that my interval, especially for NCR index, is far away from zero. So actually, while we think that zero is a reasonable value for equal strength, actually we never observe this in the level of a competition. If we go, let's say, to the Premier League, there is another interesting thing. This black line that I put here is the average over the 17 periods. And if you see, this value is always within the confidence interval created by this index. So if I try to translate it, and I know that I made, let's say, I should make a multiplicity correction, it is not statistically significantly different. I mean, there is no change over time for this index in Premier League. This is how we can interpret. Of course, I understand that I could, let's say, check and correct for multiplicity issues. So this is the second index, because something nice that came out from this research is that different indices, they do have very different, let's say, uncertainty. So here, this is the HHI index. This is what you see here are the observed values. Again, I put here some variability around. So you see that again, even this index has quite a lot of variability. Okay. And you see now that you can compare, for example, the two different championships, or let's say the same championship across years. These are the intervals for using let's say, the equal strength assumption. So you see that here we don't have the phenomenon we had for the NCR1, because NCR1 focuses on the first place. So it says something about the competition for the first place. So here we have competition for all the places. So you see a different behavior here. And this is about Premier League. Again, you see that in all time points, unless the interval contains, let's say, the average value. Okay, so this is something very insightful, and something that perhaps starts some new discussions, in the sense that what we consider as indices of competitive balance, they do have so much uncertainty that perhaps the uncertainty mess the whole thing. And this is again what we have seen. So I need to say a little more how I have constructed the confidence intervals. And Of course, this variability that I have measured depends on my model, but also we can see quite a lot of, let's say, different signals out of that. However, what I feel as very important, and this is why I would like to see comments and have some feedback, is that actually the variability is quite high. The indices that we report, actually they are vulnerable on very high variability, and perhaps this invalidates their use. And perhaps this opens the big challenge to find new ones that have less variability and they are more stable and they can, let's say, provide more information. So the intervals, as mentioned, are based on a parametric bootstrap approach in the sense that we replicate from a parametric model. And of course, what we try here is we try different indices, different scenarios, and different, let's say, assumptions as well. So let's say something that I should say, there is some work on like that from Bridgie in 2002 and Owen and King in 2013, that they try, let's say, to find using simulation for some particular indices, the level of variability. It is not exactly model-based, but actually it is simulation-based, and I think that I have admitted that this relates to my work. And there is also some related work of concentration indices in other disciplines away from sports. Of course, you may see that here my approach is model-based, but if we have a competitive balance, let's say, for other sports, we need to have some reasonable models in order to be able to replicate our approach and to work with that. The different models that I'm going to compare here, the first one is the double Poisson, so actually assume two independent Poisson distributions. And the second one, this model here in its generality assumes that the number of goals scored by team I against team J at match I follows a Poisson distribution. This is the mean. The mean depends on the home advantage, the offensive and the defensive parameters of the two teams, plus, if needed, a different home effect. So this indicates a different home effect for different teams. This is a very generic model. I can't simplify the model if I don't want, let's say, to have different home advantage. And for this particular, I mean, for German and Premier League, the home advantage can be assumed to be the same for all teams. So the final selected model is this one. So this is what is my model. There is another model, which is the one that I like more, which is the bivariate Poisson model. It is quite the same with the previous one, but now I have a bivariate distribution, not a double Poisson. So actually I have an extra parameter for correlation. From my experience, it has been shown that this small correlation parameter can affect the results, and the predictions can be a little more different. So we would like to see whether we deviate from the independence assumption to some dependence assumption, how much difference we get in the results. And this is the model, perhaps, and this is what we have fitted. So this is a second model, and the model does not assume, let's say, different home effects. Okay, so the only difference here is the extra parameter lambda 3, which is, let's say, an extra correlation that we assume. So the Fourier sampling approach is in these slides. We estimate the model using data. So if I want, let's say, to find the confidence interval for NCRR1 for English Premier League for 2000, I fit the model to the data, and then I simulate different leagues from this model. I take all the indices I calculate, and I report the empirical percentile, the confidence interval based on percentiles, and the variance, if I may, in order to have this. A big assumption here is that I base my results on a particular model. So my question here is, if I change the model, do I change the results? And this is a list of a lot of indices that we compare. And For example, there is different place, different normalized concentration ratios. This is the winning percentage of the first five teams. There are some concentration measures like gene coefficient or relative entropy and some more of that. Okay, so some results here, and this is, let's say, for English Premier League. So you see my different indices. The lines, the horizontal dotted lines, are the confidence intervals under perfect balance. I mean, all teams are equal. So what you see here is that for some indices, there is quite a lot of overlap, let's say, between the confidence interval and the observed values. For others, this is much less. This, to my eyes, implies that the kind of information that the indices can show depends heavily, the amount of information we have depends heavily on the data we have. For example, if we concentrate on the NCR1 index, this is the number of wins of just the first team. This ignores all the other information. So actually, if you think about that, you summarize your entire season in just one number that depends only what the champion has done. So you have quite a big loss of information on that. That's why the confidence intervals are too high. You see that the confidence intervals are very large, and of course, you can enter the area under full balance. So it is a very big warning that such indices that depends on very few numbers perhaps are quite problematic in practice. And you see some more here. An interesting point is that, for example, these are the concentration ratios, like the entropy, the Gini, or the HHI index. They are less, let's say, vulnerable on this, just because they use the entire, I mean, they use all the final standing. So actually, you use more information and more numbers when you calculate something like that. And the second point is that I have the same results for Bundesliga. You see that Bundesliga, more things are outside the random area, the area under full balance. It seems to me that this makes a clear signal that in Bundesliga you have, let's say, less competition, in the sense that your indices are going further away from the perfect balance assumption. You see again the different levels of variability depending on how much information you use to calculate the indices. And you see again that the indices based on concentration, they do have much less variability because they just use more numbers. Okay, so the variability, of course, depends on the size of teams. Just because it is different when you have a final standing table with 20 teams rather than 14. So you have more variability there. For some indices, the variability is large, and perhaps this invalidates their use in the sense that actually we don't learn quite a lot by just such a number. If we compare Bundesliga with English Premier League, Bundesliga shows less competition. So in the sense of less variability, further away from equal balance. And of course, if we take into account the variability, we have perhaps a different, let's say, idea about the indices. What about if we go away, if we change the model? So a big discussion here is that, well, if I take your model and I replace the Poisson assumption with a negative binomial, are there any differences in the model? So if you see here, this is for the Bundesliga, you see that using the negative binomial, the red one, the confidence intervals are pretty much the same. There is quite a small random variation between different years. So actually it seems that my results are quite robust if I change the Poisson assumption with a negative binomial assumption. The same was found if I change the double Poisson assumption with a bivariate Poisson assumption. So if I move, let's say, from the no correlation between scores to correlated scores, actually I don't have, let's say, further changes. So actually it seems quite a lot of stability. The same is true when we have Varine-Homme effect. So this is the third kind of models that we have used. So actually it seems that this approach produces quite robust results, and the results, the uncertainty results, are not, they do not depend so much on the underlying model assumption. So if I try to summarize, we try to take into account that all the indices are just random variables. They are point estimates of the unknown underlying value. So for this reason, we need to account for their stochasticity. And just reporting the values perhaps is misleading because it doesn't say a lot of things about how much uncertainty we have around that. A way to derive such variability is based on this parametric resampling approach. And of course, we need a model for doing that. We have seen some robustness if we change the model, which is good because actually we don't depend so much on the model. And we see that all the indices suffer in the sense that they produce quite large confidence intervals for a league of, let's say, 20 teams. Perhaps this implies that we need to rethink about the indices and try to use or create new indices that make use of more information. So here you have a full season of data, and actually you summarize this in a final standing, and then you report descriptives based on that. Perhaps we need to create new indices, and this is what we are working right now, that we see all the data and we calculate our seasonal indices based on the entire period and all the data available, because this will create, to my mind at least, less variability. Okay, so this is the first thing to consider. The second one is that perhaps we need, and there is some research on that, to consider indices that are not based on the final standings, but they use more information, let's say the goal difference between within the matches. This is another indication of how much the teams differ on strength, and this can be, let's say, another way to report and create such indices. And of course, the key idea is that we need to use more data than just the final standings. Well, what I have shown you today relates to the seasonal indices. So what about match indices and between season indices? So for match level, we need, let's say, a model to simulate the match itself and create the relevant indices. Of course, for modeling the match procedure, I mean not the final score, but the entire match is much less developed and has much more challenging problems. There are a few models on that, and we're working on that. And there are models, and if we have a model, you can, let's say, create similar things. For between seasons, there is also the possibility to simulate from each season, but actually, since you need to put together, you need a dynamic model that allows to change parameters between different years. There are such models, but they are quite more complicated in nature. So actually, this is doable, but we have not, let's say, we cannot report results on that. And if we want to extend to other sports, as far as you have a good model for modeling sports, for example, we are working with basketball. For basketball, there are quite a few models that actually, based on the observed league, you can estimate the model, and based on the model, you can simulate and create, again, your uncertainty around indices. The good thing with basketball is that since the score changes quite often, you can have, let's say, an idea about competitive balance within match, in the sense that you can see how much difference exists between the teams during the match. So actually, it is perhaps easier to create competitive balance measures. I think that I have to stop here. So I hope that I gave you an idea about this uncertainty thing. And I am open to questions and criticism and comments. And their comments are more than welcome, because we think that there are quite a lot of things to consider here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dimitris. Really interesting talk. Starting to think about confidence intervals around competitive balance measures. Brad had a kind of a question of clarification at one point, which is when you are presenting your Herfindahl indices, the minimum value is 1 over n. So just to check, you were subtracting 1 over n from the measure or scaling it in some way to get...
Yes, then my normalized index, it's that I rescale my index to be between 1 over n and the upper limit. So actually, I subtract the minimum and I divide by the range.
Okay. Super. And then Stefan Szymanski has a question about the measures being based on points, so 3 points for a win versus 2 points for a win, and how that can have a difference. I noticed that you mentioned that you had a slide about correcting for the number of teams in the division. Did you also correct for the point system as well?
Okay, yeah, that's correct. I mean, we have used the 2-1-0 system just because of easiness on the data we had, in the sense that we didn't need, let's say, to make any sense. But what we have seen is that the variability is even larger, because the 3 versus 2 points for the win creates more variability. So actually, the situation is slightly worse, in the sense that you have more variability on that. But the central idea is the same, I think.
Yeah. I mean, it struck me as it's quite astonishing that you could have measures for the Premier League. I think that was someone unmuted by accident.
Okay, that's interesting. Not easy, because actually, you know, you have less matches there, and since you don't have a round robin, I mean, all teams don't play together. You need to use some proxy in order, let's say, to put together all the data. To put it another way, let's say that you have the full season Champions League data. The teams play in the groups, and then they play knockouts. So you have a few crossings. So in order to calculate the strength of a team, you don't have sufficient matches. Or if you calculate the strength of the team, you have quite large variability. And this can create very messy situations. So you need some better models. But actually, this is a nice research in the sense how much you can adjust this for this. I think this worth, let's say, further investigation.
Hmm. It also struck me that you're kind of moving almost towards a test of the, you know, the difference away from equally balanced teams by what you're doing. So you could almost see each measure is giving you a test of the null hypothesis.
Oh, you mean a proper test statistic or something like that?
Yeah, a test of whether teams are equally balanced, something like that.
Actually, yes. Actually, since you have a bootstrap approach, you can create bootstrap tests for that. So actually, you need a summary measure, a test statistic that has sufficient power. In the paper we are preparing, we have used, let's say, a measure of variance around the line. For that, we don't know exactly how much power this test can have, but actually you can have a bootstrap test on that.
Mm. It looked like, I mean, to me, that some of those indices can't have much power if they think that the Premier, if you can't reject the null that teams are equally balanced in the Premier League. You know, I mean, there's no way teams are equally balanced in the Premier League by any kind of metric. So that's what, you know, that's just some of the indices probably have quite low power.
Yes. It is challenging. I don't have a clue on that.
Yeah. Stefan, a lot of research in the area moving away from comparative balance, whose value to consumers is far from clear, towards measures such as suspense and surprise. I don't know if you've thought about that, Dimitris.
Not really. No. No. But I'm not aware of all this. But I don't have an answer. No. Let's say no.
Yeah, then you can get measures of surprise by things like, you know, how things have changed recently in terms of betting prices, things like that, and suspense.
What we try now is that we try to create indices, but I don't have something to show you within the season. So actually, let's say an example: if you take the standings for each particular day, and you see how much they change. This can be an idea of the balance you have or not, because by chance you expect, let's say, that you have a lot of fluctuations, but of perfect balance. But if you have, let's say, a team that starts from the first day to be in the first position until the end of the season, and nothing changes in the rankings, perhaps this is an indication that the competition is not there.
Yeah. Stefan, I don't know if you wanted to follow up. That at all. We can move so to people unmuting themselves if they want to.
Yeah, I think the issue is that, I mean, ultimately we want to relate these measures to something that has to do with demand. And I think the problem is that the literature doesn't really support the idea that there's much demand for competitive balance. And whereas these measures like surprise and suspense, there's clearly starting to emerge pretty good evidence that the consumers do really care about that. So, I mean, I think you can still do this kind of analysis, but in that context, and I think it will make it more policy relevant. I think that's a kind of a useful way to try and move things in the future.
I agree. And I know that there are some econometric models that try to relate competitive balance with economic issues like attendance or other things. So if we think that this is just a descriptive measure, so it is actually an error in variable with variable with error. So actually, perhaps this will validate or invalidate some of the models, because actually, if you take into account the variability in this reported index, a lot of things can be different. That's what I'm afraid of. Because now we treat them as the true value, but actually it seems that it is quite variable, and perhaps all those econometric models that use competitive balance indices to relate to other variables perhaps are problematic.
Yeah, I guess there must be something there, because when you're thinking about something like surprise, often that's measured by a change. So you might think about it being a change in one of these measures of competitive balance. It reflects over a number of game weeks, say Liverpool keep losing 7-2. That would be quite a surprising change of events. But then obviously, equally, to some extent, if you're taking the difference of two numbers.
Yes. That's what I said, that the score difference perhaps is another way. Because even if the score is 7-2 or 2-1, it's the same for the final standings. So yeah, we don't see that in the calculations of any of the indices. So actually, yes, this is the problem, that you don't take into account, let's say, some particular things. If all the scores were, let's say, 1-0, I mean, all the wins were just 1-0, you have the same final standing. But actually, the competition is much higher if you have all the scores 1-0, don't you?
Yeah, absolutely. Although surely the goal difference would make a difference, presumably between everything being 1-0 and everything being 7-2.
Yes.
Jean-Louis has got his hand up with a question.
Yes, congratulations for this very challenging presentation. I just would like to know if you did you try some resampling, other resampling procedures, bootstrap, not based on the model?
No. The answer is no, but it is not easy to consider what kind. I mean, if we move away from parametric bootstrap to some non-parametric, it is hard, let's say, to envision how we can do it. It's not standard, don't you? Am I wrong? I don't know. If you have something in mind, I would be glad to hear.
Replicating some teams, for instance, or things like that.
What we have considered, but we stopped it, is to consider some sensitivity stuff. I mean that to add in the observed, let's say, scores, some jitter, some noise.
Okay. Yeah.
This way, but there's no standard theory how this can be, let's say, the correct variability that we want to generate.
Okay.
If you understand. I mean, it is rather a sensitivity, so I wouldn't say that this is variance. So if I report confidence intervals with that, I'm not sure whether this makes sense. I don't know. I'm still being statistician, that's the problem, not practitioner.
Okay, any more questions? Dennis. You're still on mute, Dennis. I don't know if,
Thanks, Dimitris. This was really very interesting. I have a question related to the use of the indices in a practical sense. So, as I understand what you've argued, it's that the metrics are just a point estimate of a random variable, and that there is some error associated with that point estimate.
Yes.
In terms of using that random variable as a regressor, say in an attendance demand equation, the issue would be twofold. One, is it a good proxy for the true measure? And it's somewhat clear maybe that you're saying that it's not a good proxy of the true measure, but I'm not positive about that. And the second thing is whether the randomness in it would be correlated with any of the other explanatory variables, such leading to bias. And so I'm curious if you have some sort of a story that one might tell about why that random error is correlated with other explanatory variables, and therefore something we should be concerned about creating bias.
Okay, this is a nice question. My answer is that I don't have anything to say about the correlation with other variables. What we have seen is that there is some, let's say, preliminary result that as point estimate, there is some bias. And this is also problematic. I mean that it is not easy to check what is the true value and to see what we estimate for that. Because actually we start by a model and it is very hard, let's say, to find what is the model value. If, for example, I assume, to put another way, if you assume perfect balance in our model, you expect an index of zero, but you never see zero. So to me, this is a kind of, let's say, bias. We tried, let's say, some specific scenarios, assuming some specific values of lambda for very small things that we can do the mathematics, and we have an indication that there is some bias on the indices. So actually those indices are not well understood as point estimates of some true population value. So my concern is that we are using them as a proxy for something that perhaps is biased. The correlation thing is something that we have not worked at all. But I think the problem comes from this fact, that this can be quite biased.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dennis. Any more questions or comments? I think there's something quite interesting, isn't it? Just as a comment, in terms of assuming that teams have equal strength over a 306 game season or 380 game season, presumably you're not in your simulations, you're not including any kind of measure of team strength, but you have to imagine that team strengths change over the course of a 10-month season, right?
That's true, but we simulate based on this assumption. So actually, if you have a dynamic model that allows to change a little bit the strength within the season, you can do it. We don't have such a model at the moment, but it's a matter of the underlying model. However, I agree that perhaps one may check whether these lambdas should change. And of course, this creates another thing, because if we change the strength parameters, actually we assume that the competitive balance is different in different parts of the year.
Yeah.
Which is another interesting, let's say, point of view and thing that we would like to measure about. Is the competition at the first part of the year the same with the second one? Well, you may assume that some teams are not any more interested in anything, so they don't care. So it's a matter of, it's an interesting point, how we can, let's say, compare something like that.
And of course, there's also the transfer window that happens in the middle of all of these seasons.
I have seen some paper, but okay. As you know, I'm now the editor of Journal of Quantitative Analysis in Sports, and there is some research on that, how we can compare the first and the second half of the uncertainty. And it seems that the uncertainty in the second half is usually less than the first one, because more teams are not are different in the second part.
Okay, final opportunity for comments, questions. In which case, we can say thank you, Dimitris.
Okay, it was my pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for your kind invitation. And thank everybody for attending this late Friday. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Dimitris. And as you mentioned, maths sport is due to take place in Reading next year. We're currently working out exactly how it might take place in Reading next year. It might be online only, it might be online and in person. But watch the space for the maths sport conference in 2021. Much more short term, next week we return. We have another online seminar, same time next week, October the 23rd. We have Rayo Tanji of Osaka University presenting reference, dependence and monetary incentives, evidence from Major League Baseball. So I look forward to seeing all of you there. And in the meantime, I wish you a happy rest of your day, however short or long that is, and a great weekend.
Thank you very much, James. Bye to everybody.